one's called Kerosene. My name is Anthony Cross. I'll be your host tonight. And tonight we have the Coves on our
Should
panel.
We clap ourselves?
Yeah, clap everyone. We've got an audience.
Thank you, everyone.
You might as well clap. All right.
Nice.
Booyah. Got you right when you were drinking. Anyway, so how are you guys feeling? Feel good?
Fantastic.
You guys just played an awesome set. Everyone here heard it. Come on. Clap.
Thank you.
Clap. Everyone's happy. Good. So, how was your Valentine's Day? You buy each other flowers? What did you do?
I had a great Valentine's Day.
What'd you do?
You did have a good Valentine's Day.
I had a good Valentine's Day. Yeah, good Valentine's Day, actually.
Yeah, the rest of us were...
We explored each other.
We explored
history, yeah.
You know, you take Valentine's Day in a lot of directions, and we definitely took it to one extreme, and
someone call it love, but I don't. They don't look like it.
Someone call. I think you kept saying in the middle of that, like,
I love you,
yeah. And I was like, stop looking at
see,
me.
No, but see,
and then you were holding the camera, and I was like, hold it steady.
See, I feel like we're just mammals, and we did it like they do on the Discovery Channel.
Wow. I love letting these conversations just blossom into this horrible flower of shit.
You asked a question.
if only you knew it was true.
Well, we'll never know, I guess. But anyway, so have you guys ever done a show like this before?
No.
Not quite like this.
Well, I mean, oftentimes after we play a show, everyone who was usually heavily drinking thinks this is a great idea to come to the Cove's house. Most of the time uninvited. And so we'll roll up and unpack all of our things, and then there's so many people are there, we're like, oh, well, we couldn't play these songs, so we go down into our basement, which is like, doesn't have these nice vaulted ceilings, or isn't like this beautiful of a room, or sound anything as great as this place does.
But higher ground.
Yeah. It's higher ground. This place is higher ground in comparison. We are definitely underwater in our basement, and this is higher ground. And we set up all of our stuff, and we play, we usually play very intoxicated, fun shows, and nobody's ever there to film or do anything. So
we have a little bit of a genre. With this, the most elaborate setup I've probably ever seen.
It's a good setup.
You guys will see it in the filming, but it's a very elaborate.
Thank you.
Also, the cool part about, and I don't mean to detract from the rest of the band by anything, it just was in the bio, you're a pianist, and you went to drums.
Yeah.
Did that take very long, or was that kind of like
it was awful. I ruined so many shows in the beginning.
Oh, really?
Yeah, in the very beginning, we first started off, it was bad, like, every crash. It's true. It was real.
Just like,
you know what
it's
happened.
Like,
yeah.
It was like Steve Martin the Jerk.
Oh yeah.
You see him when he tries to get that rhythm. That was me like trying to drum.
Literally this just kind
nothing.
Of
nothing. Yeah, it was literally like just robotic. It was awful.
That's the worst.
So it took time, but no.
Well,
it's really fun now.
I mean, yeah, but now you sound really, I mean, it sounds natural.
Yeah.
You know, it sounds good, but I just think it's awesome that you know, you started out on keys, and I'm a keys player, you know, and transitioning to drums. I've always found it difficult to get some stuff down, but it took some time just sitting down and figuring it out, and then it goes from there. And then kind of you over there, I'm not looking at you, I'm looking at you.
Oh.
Joined the party. You joined all of your fellow addicts by also defecting from Texas.
It was a great story, actually.
Oh, tell us about it.
No, man, it was just a night, there was a big flood around here, and there was a night where I got stuck out in the rain, and I was walking back, and I met these guys, and they were jamming in their house, and I was completely soaked in the rain.
It's cliche, yeah.
Yeah, it's true, though.
He literally wasn't a
bad. No, what's more cliche about it is that neither of these guys were there when he walked up, and it was just me sitting in an open window.
I had no
jamming
idea.
Out to music.
And
you
just walked up and said, "Hey, that's sweet music."
I've been looking for people to jam with since I moved here, and I saw this fucker jamming in his window.
We fell in love.
And I just walked up and was like, "Hey, are you trying to jam? Like, are you trying to get this going?" And then when he was talking to me, Josiah walked by the window and he said, he was talking to me like, "Yeah, are you free Thursday?" and blah, 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 what the fuck ever. And Josiah walked by and he's like, "Oh, by the way, that's the drummer." And I was like, "Oh."
That's the answer. That's it.
That's it.
And then he was in the band.
A little Combs introduction for you. Yeah.
And welcome to our life.
We live at this
point. Now we all live together.
That was a good story. So after that, you guys started touring through California and played a bunch of shows and stuff like that, which is really, really cool. I mean, this wasn't instantaneous, obviously. He didn't just, like, randomly show up and be like, then you guys were like, "Hey, we're going to California tomorrow, woo!" And then, like, went. So there was time that elapsed, I'm assuming.
It was four months.
Four months? That's healthy. You know, that's enough time to get everyone in the rhythm of things and not literally get you fucking sorted out. But no, like, you know, get everyone solid with their parts. Yeah. And then tell us about the tour. Like, you just went over through California and you played, what is it, Hotel Cafe, something like that?
In LA.
Yeah, that's really cool.
Well, the three of us are originally from California, so it was only natural that, you know, we went back to our roots. And
it's close enough, too. I mean, it's not terrible driving distance.
Two states.
Yeah.
But, so we rented a trailer and threw all it in there and booked a few shows up and down the coast, and then it was a really good time. Man, our family's out there, so, you know, we didn't play to empty rooms.
Right. The last thing in the About Me section is the line, "Staying true to their roots, the Tight-Knit Four-Piece has no plan of relenting from palpable success." Now, their roots, what is that? Like, what are your roots? Because on the multiple websites that I've seen, there's really no indication to exactly where your roots come from. And to me, it sounds like early Coldplay. You know, it definitely has that, like, kind of parachute-y vibe to it, that album Parachute.
Great, yeah.
And I know.
That's be great.
You nailed that on the hammer.
Yeah.
I mean, it arose from, like, Sai and I, growing up around, my dad was just endlessly, like, obsessed with early Coldplay, early Radiohead. Yeah, absolutely. Like, P.O. and Damien Rice. Mm-hmm. And they all kind of stem to the different side of, like, that, the man being the victim, I guess, kind of in music, where you can, like, relay this an intense amount of emotion without always having to, like, stay behind, you know, electric guitar and you know, hide behind your lyrics and act like everything's okay. And then Johnny came from punk roots,
I mean, Johnny, before he moved out here, it was a punk bassist, actually, and had never, like, picked up a guitar seriously prior to. And then Adam...
I mean, that's amazing. That's two now have kind of, like, changed their instruments. Mm-hmm. And I mean, that's an amazing feat on any level, honestly. Mm-hmm. I mean, relearning an instrument or learning a new instrument on top of an old one is always... Right. It's easier than picking it up from... dead stop, dead nothing, but that's really amazing. But well, anyway,
it's really the same thing with Adam too, though, because Adam used to be a lead guitarist in his band and then always wanted to be a bassist, so he decided to be a bassist. Johnny, being a bassist, always wanted to be a lead guitarist, and then Saya was just stuck with whatever.
I got the leftovers.
I was about to say, it seems like this band is the band that everyone got to do what they wanted.
I did not want to be the drummer.
Well, good for you, now it's cool.
And we kind of created this group that, you know, in the beginning it was like, I wouldn't say it was difficult at all, but, you know, everyone was, you would wake up early in the morning, and since everyone is so obsessed with music, we would endlessly just be talking about, or I guess listening to, like, whatever your flavor of the day was, and every single time that, you know, you would wake up and hear Johnny's room blasting, it would be, like, either crazy punk, or it would be Jimi Hendrix or SRB. Nice. Yeah, and then you would, you know, listen to Adam's room, and it would be, like, Sublime or the Toolies. And then it
Toadies.
And then, like, Sai and I always, you know, we've grown up together, so we've always listened to the same music. So we blast the same music back
depending
and forth.
Depending on the day, if
and
it's then, raining or something.
Yeah, no kidding.
Exactly. And then you all pick up your instruments, and you kind of, like, sit there, like, all right, you've been listening to punk all day. You've been listening to, like, a kind of reggae feel. We've been listening to this whole vibe, and you're not even a drummer. You're a pianist. Like, what are we going to even play? And then immediately it clicked. And, I mean, within 2 months, we recorded... 4 tracks that was like this just little kind of demo called Cliche that had like a couple of like, you know, poppy songs and then sad songs, and it drew from a lot of different things. And then shortly after that, I mean 2 months later, then we left to California and recorded like the live in Los Angeles at the Hotel Cafe, which was like
those are on Reverb Nation.
Yeah, those are on Reverb Nation right now. And then right now we've you know, we've endlessly been taking steps because we've always wanted to be the band that could play a live sound and actually have it sound fucking good in comparison to, you know, I always have had that, like, restraint against liking a band who can do it on an album and can't do it live. So,
well, it just kind of shows, you know, that it's not completely together.
You let me down. If you should go,
the fact that most bands at our age were kind of all around the same age, early 20-somethings. I shouldn't mention that. Anyway, at that age, you know, our parents and our friends of our parents, friends of the family, kind of look at the musician's lifestyle, the idea of being artistic and doing something in the creative field is a little bit of a waste of time. Now, you know, have you found support from your family and your family friends and stuff from moving out from California to here, you know, and doing this band all the way away from home and all kinds of stuff. I mean, I left home when I was 19 and I came out here. And I know my parents, or my mother at least, is like, where are you, you know, like kind of the kind of a little bit of a controlling, but I love her very much. love you, Mom. But anyway, you know, that's the thing, is it's you know, the motherly care, and some of the family friends will be like, oh, you're wasting your time, you need to go and get a business degree or some shit like that. But what have you encountered, you know, through that entire thing?
I don't know if
thing?
I can speak for all of us. I'm pretty
sure
that I can.
For each other, you know.
No, yeah, I think that we're all pretty fortunate with the support system that we have. Yeah, we're not getting pulled or pushed in any direction to do one certain thing. It's kind of follow your dream. And I think it comes from, this is my personal belief, I think that we all can agree on it, is that you get one chance in life to, like, push something, you know, as hard as
your dreams.
Yeah, as hard as you can, and we're in it. We're in the prime of our lives to push something, and I think that our family and friends see that and support it.
Yeah, and I think that's cool. And is it your dad is here today?
He's always here.
I mean, that's amazing. I think that is truly something really awesome that you do. And I have to, you know, raise the glass a little bit to that. I mean, I've been fortunate as well. My parents support me with what I do, but it's a little bit more rare when it comes to musicians. And
absolutely,
I don't mean to generalize,
but
it's a little bit more rare that, you know, your dad's here, your parents are here, they care, you know, they care about it. That's cool. And I think that's something that we need to say, because that's a really interesting,
it's a great example.
Exactly. Yeah. I mean, like you just said, you're in the prime of your life. This is the time to try and push something that is your dream. And why not? You know,
absolutely.
The other thing that I think is interesting is some of the gigs that you guys have been getting. It's different to any other band that's kind of around. They're corporate gigs. You want to tell us about that a little bit?
Yeah, I mean, we've kind of taken, I don't know, it's hard when you're in such a competitive music industry to follow suit with a lot of things, and we've tried to break from that barrier as much as possible. I mean, like you brought up earlier, the setup alone, you know, like we try to go so eccentric in so many ways that it's like you remember that we had such an intense setup, even though we don't want to break down and set that up everywhere we go. We have to do it, like, to create this, you know, this feeling of like, when the coast come through town, this is what happens.
You're trying to create your uniqueness through your surroundings and your atmosphere.
And that's how we got, like, I mean, the most recent of, like, the corporate gigs, you could say, are writing a track for a new apartment complex that's opening up on Campus West in Fort Collins, to where we were playing a gig. Like, this was totally inadvertent. We didn't reach out to him. Nothing had ever happened to where we knew what was happening. But we played a gig on Halloween, and we have this code. Well, it's mainly my my dad and I talk about ideas. I bounce things off of him, and he's like, you know what, that sounds interesting. And then I enforce it upon the band.
God, yeah, it's so enjoyable.
Yeah,
you seem like the convincer.
I'm very good at convincing them.
The
convincer. Valentine's Day was
put
a great
this dress on and grab your guitar, Johnny. Let's go.
Yeah, I saw those pictures.
Yeah. That's how we got that
Halloween show. Go
and
look
that's
it
what
on Facebook.
That's exactly what happened. Is that we decided, you know, it's Halloween show. Like, everybody was saying, like, oh, we should wear, like, this kind of costume, like, this and that. And they were so generic of things. And we were like, what if we cross-dressed and took a bunch of Wizard of Oz costumes? And since I don't have a heart. and they all relayed so perfectly, because I don't have a heart, so I was the tin heartthrob.
Yeah,
and then, you heard him say it.
And you, what was it? The pride?
I
you have no pride?
No, courage.
Courage, no courage. And then, what, you were afraid of everything?
Yeah, sultry scarecrow.
Sultry scarecrow. And what were you at?
I thought it was Christina Brain, dude. That's...
I was Dorothy.
Because he had extremely long hair.
Because he had the hair.
Because I look like a woman.
But we headed on the stage, it dressed up in these suits, or dresses, I guess. And it turned out to be a very fun gig for us to play.
It looked miserable for you, the one picture that I did see, because you were just kind of like...
Oh, there was a lot of like, well, I am dressed in spandex and it's I can peel this off of myself.
It looked kind of uncomfortable, but it still looked fun.
That was one show we had to let our music do the talking instead of like our stage presence.
Yeah,
like,
exactly.
And this we wear dresses, but still.
This led to that the corporate gig, yeah. Because right afterwards, like after all the rest of the bands had played, we got approached by someone, or I guess two people who were partners in this new complex, and they were like, hey, I think you embody a certain image that we want to portray with our apartment complex, I guess, with like this new, like, we're young, we're youth, fruitful, life, vitality, yeah, this is college life, this is freedom. Like, yeah, testing the limits. and I feel like they thought we tested the limits enough. It was a good time, and they asked us to write a song that embodied that college experience, and within like a week we had recorded that song and let it out to them, and we're recording a video with In the Shed Media, which are just incredible people, and I'm just really excited about like what comes out of that.
So that's really cool, and I mean that's the reason why I bring it up is because I don't think a lot of musicians who are in bands realize that these corporate gigs do exist. Mm-hmm. And I think most people are eligible for it. It doesn't just have to do with a certain kind of aesthetic or a certain kind of appearance. I mean, you guys are very attractive as men, of course. Here's the thing.
Anthony.
Ditto. Ditto, man.
It got hot in here.
Hold on, Anthony. Whoa. Why don't you go ahead and sip on that real quick?
You want to keep drinking, man. It's going to get crazy. Wow, natural. Nice.
The sucking in. That is I've never seen that, but that is very smooth.
Anyway, you guys have to understand that you guys are good looking, you know. But I don't think it has to be limited.
Why, thank you.
I heard a one woo. I get a more of a woo just for the
wolf whistles. I'm not a piece of meat.
We're not objects.
How do you feel being objectified?
I feel great, Anthony.
I surrender. I encounter more sass than my cat when I get home. I don't get any more from you. On the end of it. All right. But anyway, no, I think it's cool that you guys got a corporate gig. I think it's awesome because I think more musicians need to know about it. So the other thing too, what do you guys have planned for the future? Do you guys have any tour dates posted? What's coming up? Like what's got you jazzed for the future?
Big plans. Yeah. Big plans.
The new city though. That's a big new plan. No one could talk about
it. Yeah, we're working on an album right now. Full length album. That's our first debut album, yeah. Woo. One day the song makes sense.
There we go. There it is. First debut album.
We are very excited about that.
Do you know when that's coming out, or do you have any ideas? Sometime soon.
March 15th.
March 15th. Is there going to be a release show or anything like that?
Absolutely.
We're headed to the terrible part about like actually releasing it at that time and doing release shows, so we might end up doing it like releasing a little bit later, even though it's ready, is that we're going to South by Southwest on the 28th. Yeah, so it's like.
Come on, that's fucking awesome. That's fucking sweet. You got to mention that too.
We are very excited.
We've got plenty of outlets here. Yeah,
exactly. So like during that whole week, we're going to Texas and we're doing like this whole Dallas and Austin, which Adam's from Dallas, so he's super excited to go to. So we're doing a whole like Texas tour and then coming back up during our spring break. So like the whole like release dates and deadlines are kind of like up in the air, but. I'm really excited. This is finally like the first thing that we've recorded that like I feel like I have to live up to when we play it live. Yeah. You know, like I mean nobody else has heard it, so at this point like it's kind of strange to talk about it, but it's a great
The thing
great
is album. Is this video is going to exist far past the time when it becomes released.
Yeah. So hopefully it speaks for itself.
Your album comes out. So yeah, no.
Somebody's gonna be like, wow, he was really blowing a bunch of smoke.
Yeah, he was totally fucking wrong. This album sucked.
You know, this is the new Coldplay Parachutes, man.
I mean after hearing your guys' performance, I think it's gonna be a wonderful album. I wish you guys the best of luck at South by Southwest. That's so cool. I mean, that's a huge honor and cool thing to do. You know, you guys, I'm excited to see the new album when it comes out, and you know, we'll keep in touch for sure. But at this juncture, we've got to end. Thank you so much for watching. This has been Live at Higher Ground with the Coves and myself, Anthony Cross. Yeah. Have a good night.
This is the Coves with their song No Stranger to Love.
Guess that's my cue, Coach.
in my mind. I wanted you to stay. But I ain't no stranger to love. No, I ain't no stranger to.
Stranger to love.